So I'm going to talk about Lambda architecture today. It's a new way to build distributed systems, build distributed data systems, and you know how we utilize it to analyze large-scale unstructured dynamic data at index. So we've been using it for about 10 years. So this is going to be our journey about you know how we ended up implementing a Lambda architecture at index. So before we start, you know, I'd like to give a quick overview of index. So at Index, you know, we are trying to build the world's largest product database for brands, retailers, and developers. So what do I mean by that? You know, we like to provide price and product intelligence and answer these questions. So a few example questions are, am I priced higher or lower with respect to my competitor on, let's say, a product like Nikon D700? An interesting question there is at the bottom, which is, what is the average price change of all Nike shoes in Walmart in the last 3 months? So we answer questions for customers, I mean, these kind of questions. And how do we do it? For that, you know, let me talk about the data pipeline at Index. You know, how do we get this data to customers? The first thing is, you know, we crawl the web. We do a focus crawl of the web to get product information. So what you see is a product page there. And how do we do it? We crawl the web. Next part of the data pipeline is what we call parsing, where we convert this unstructured or sort of semi-structured HTML into structured product records. A product page might contain a title, a price, availability, spec text, or unstructured data like description. We extract this data and convert it into product records using a set of manual as well as machine vision based algorithms. And we do this for thousands of sites. The next step is what we call classification, where we use machine learning algorithms which have models, where you know we build models and we try to annotate these product pages into different categories, which is based on our taxonomy. The next part of our data pipeline is, you know, we take this products which are categorized and we try to cluster them to get similar products that are sold across stores. For example, an iPhone 5 64 GB might be sold in multiple stores, so we cluster them using, again, you know, clustering algorithms. And that happens in this step. And this finally, you know, goes into our catalog, which contains products and prices. The next step in our pipeline is what we call analytics. You know, we take this product and price catalog and do pre-computations and insights in multiple dimensions. We also create a search index, which allows you to search for data in the catalog. And finally, we expose all this to end users via multiple endpoints, like we have an app, we have an API, and we also expose via mobile. And this is a small announcement I need to make. We just released the version 1 of our API today. If you want to know more about us, you know, you can go to developer.index.com. Okay, so this is a quick overview about the data pipeline at Index. The next thing I want to do is, you know, talk about some of the challenges we have in building this data pipeline. The first thing is this data is dynamic. What do I mean by that? So if you see the product page, you know, it's dynamically changing in the sense that, you know, e-commerce companies are adding more information as they get information about the product. So our parsers need to keep up to that. So our parsers need to extract this information. For example, a specification text could be added into a product page. So next time when our parsers parse, they should be able to extract it. Similarly, there could be information that is there on the product page, but our parsers could not extract it for various reasons. You know, maybe we've not written code to extract it. But let's say once we do that, we need to go back and reparse and look at the historical data and extract this information. An example of this is availability or, you know, sizes or colors or other types of attributes. There's also other stuff like our ML models. Our ML models are also evolving on a regular basis, which means that our categorization can become finer and coarser. So a product which was categorized as a shoe might be categorized as something like a sneaker. So I mean, these are things that keep on changing on a regular basis as our ML algorithms evolve. Now what happens because of all this is because categorization is an important aspect for building the rest of the pipeline. So when this changes, we need to go back and recompute all the other stuff the product and the price catalog. Not only this, even that our recomputation that you saw for analytics and search index also need to be changed. I mean, you could go back and, you know, selectively update data, but you know that's too complex. And the reason behind that is, we also need to work at scale. So our product catalog currently has about 400 million product URLs. On a daily basis, we crawl 4 terabyte of HTML data, and our data pipeline processes about 100 terabyte data on a daily basis. So given all this, you know, we looked at implementing the first version of our data pipeline. So this was almost 2 years back. And this is how our data pipeline looked like 2 years back. We implemented a batch system using HBase and MapReduce. So our storage layer is implemented in HBase, and our processing is done by MapReduce. Now, why did we choose HBase? We were primarily inspired by Google's Bigtable paper, because, you know, we wanted a system that could store millions of documents, or millions of HTML documents in this case. And that and the Bigtable architecture is also very similar, you know, because the white table architecture of Bigtable allows you to store your HTML page as one of the column families, and you have the other information that gets extracted subsequently in other column families. So we use that approach, and we also like for example here, what will happen is the crawler will write the HTML pages into the first column family. The parser will read the data from there and then write it to the next column family, and so on and so forth. So this was in production for a year, but we ran into multiple problems. So I'll just go through them one by one. The first thing is, okay, I mean, there's a red arrow, there's a red circle there. So any guesses on, you know, what could be the problem? I mean, focus on the arrows. So what could be one of the problems with this? Sorry, right? Okay. So I heard mutation somewhere. Yes. So that was one of the biggest problems for us, where multiple systems would write and read from a single column family. So that used to, so there was a lot of mutation that was happening, and we ran into the same issues that plague concurrent systems. So what used to happen is issues that would occur. It was very difficult to reason out, you know, what was the real cause of any issue that occurred in these systems. And another problem with mutable systems is what I call human fault tolerance. To put this into perspective, you know, let me ask a question here. How many of you have written an update statement and forgot to have the where clause? Can you please raise your hands? I was expecting more, but okay. I don't think, I mean, you are a professional programmer if you're not done that. Okay. So the point I want to make is that, you know, bugs are inevitable. I mean, we as humans make mistakes. So what we want is our data systems to help us recover from these systems. So in this system, what used to happen is that if a bug was made, and there is a cascading effect, because each system takes its input as the output of the previous system. So what this would mean is that, you know, we'll run into what are called Byzantine errors, where a small error here will appear as a big problem in the downstream systems. And there was no way for us to recover, because the data was immutable. And there are some war stories around it that I can talk about, but we used to run into migration jobs, you know, that'll try to recover, and we were not very sure whether we recovered everything or not. So what we learned, what was the hard lesson that we learned from this, is data systems should be human fault tolerant. Okay, this was the second problem we faced. Again, there's a question coming. So this is a plot of our request per second versus time of the HBase throughput, write and read throughput. So write is in green, and blue is and write and reads are in blue. So you can see the downward spike there. Any guesses on what is the downward spike? Sorry? Running a query. Okay, but I mean, we've been running queries, you know, reads are happening else in the other before that also, right? Okay, what is running every 30 minutes? Okay, so what's running every 30 minutes is compactions. If you people are familiar with HBase, you know, HBase uses compactions to ensure that, you know, the read performance is not affected. So I'll maybe spend a minute about talking about what are compactions. So to ensure, you know, heavy write throughput, what HBase does is it stores everything that all new data that comes in into memory in what is called memstore. And as soon as the memstore goes beyond a particular limit, it actually flushes it into the disk. Now the files that are flushed into disk are immutable. Now the problem with this is that, you know, if the files are small, the read time is affected. So what HBase does is it goes through what are called compactions, which you can either you can turn it off, or, you know, you can tune it whenever you want to run, or it can run on a periodic basis. So what the compactions would do is they'll compact smaller files into bigger ones that'll improve read performance. So what happens during that time is because these compactions are disk and CPU intensive, the performance of edge space, both read and write, goes for a toss. What I mean by that, and the analogy is very similar to how JVM garbage collection happens. You know, you have to tune it, you know. So so we also tried a lot of tuning techniques, but we realized that, you know, we were not able to guarantee performance of edge space, because, you know, if we turn off edge based compactions, read performance would be affected. So what is the lesson we learned from this? We learned that, you know, random write databases are hard to manage at large scale. The third problem. So this batch process would used to take 16 hours to run. We used to run it on a periodic, on a regular basis. It used to run in a while loop. So it used to take 16 hours. Now the problem with this is that the business will not agree with, you know, this higher latency. 16 hours latency is a lot. We wanted it to be a couple of hours. So I'll just summarize the three problems. So no human fault tolerance because of mutable state, operational complexity because of random writes and compactions, and high latency. And batch systems are architecturally, you know, you can't guarantee low latency in batch systems because of all the bookkeeping and all the overhead that is required for running jobs. So I'll come back to these three problems. I'll refer to them again in the presentation. Okay, it was chaos for us about a year back, primarily because of these three problems, and we realized that we had to rethink our data systems from scratch. So our approach, although, you know, we read the research papers and it all looked fine, but it didn't work in reality because of the problems. That's when, you know, we started looking into Lambda architecture, and it seemed to be a step in the right direction. So what is Lambda architecture? It's an approach to build big data systems. It provides you guidance on architectural components and principles, and it tells you how to tie batch and real-time systems together. It is general purpose. We applied it to our domain, but, you know, the concepts can be applied to your domain also. So it's been coined by Nathan Marks. He's an ex-Twitter engineer and creator of Storm, a real-time processing engine. Okay. So one of the key concepts in Lambda architecture is in the next two slides. This is how, you know, we built the data system. So we had HBase, which was the source of truth, and we had application, and the application would read and write to HBase. What we had to build was this, where you have to store an immutable raw data, in an immutable store, which acts as your source of truth, and you create process views out of it, and your application should read from the process views. It should not update the immutable data store. So this is something, you know, this slide is something, you know, that I'll maybe pause for a few seconds here. You know, if I could time travel, you know, and there's something technically that I could tell myself two years before, I think this is what it would be if you need to build a data system at scale. And this I'll again refer to this slide in the subsequent part of the presentation. So again, you know, this is a traditional approach, and this is a new approach we're talking about. Okay, so to concretize this particular approach, you know, let's take a small example. So let's try to find the count of unique products in any given category for the entire time range. So the key thing is any given category and for the entire time range, which means that you can't do on-the-fly computations. You need to pre-compute these values. So let's take a stab at implementing this solution. And of course, you know, there are two requirements that we can't forget. The data is dynamic, which means that, you know, you need to recompute or whatever the other technique that you need to use, but you need to ensure that, you know, all the dynamic nature of the data is taken care of. And it also needs to be large scale. You might have millions of products in a given category. So let's try to look at implementing a batch layer. So the first thing that you need to decide is, how do I build this immutable data store? What are the properties of this immutable data store? So one stab at it is, you could have an append-only data store where all new data is appended to the current hour. So which means that, you know, if data that's coming to, if new data is getting added, it'll only get appended. There's no mutation that's happening. It's just getting appended to the end of the data store. So in this case, what I've done is I've depicted products as boxes and colors represent category. We're not working with HTML data here. We're working with structured product data, which is already categorized. Now you can see that the data is already fragmented. You see that products are at different time boundaries, but similar products are not together. Now, if you go back to the query, what we wanted to do was we want to find the unique products in a given category. But this view is not the data store is not conducive to that. So what you need to do is you need to build a view which allows us to efficiently answer those queries. So you can do something like this. And yeah, so this one point here is that we used HDFS for doing this vertical partitioning. So what you can do is you can write an MR job that will convert this view into the view that you need, so that you can make efficient queries. So here what I've done is I've converted that into a category based view where all the products in a given category are stored, are stored with a particular character. In HDFS, you'll represent them in directories. Now the next thing is you need to do the actual calculation. So you can write another MR job that will go through each of these categories and then do a unique of the products in that category. Now you get this batch view, and you can implement this batch view in HBase. The final step is when somebody asks for a query, you actually refer to this HBase view and get the data out. Okay, so let's see how this solves some of the requirements. First requirement was recomputations. So whenever there is new data that comes into the product master data, you actually recompute the intermediate views and the batch view. So replace the old batch view with the new one. The second problem was scale. The second requirement was scale. So you can handle scale by using Hadoop HDFS and MapReduce and HBase. All these three technologies are proven to work at scale. And especially HDFS and MapReduce, we've heard of, of examples, where it works at petabyte scale on thousands of machines. And HBase itself, we know that scales to terabytes. So the two requirements that our original data pipeline implementation had, which was recomputation and scale, is handled by this new one. Now let's see, how if it handles the problems or not. Again, recap of the three problems. Let's look at them one by one. What about human fault tolerance? By human fault tolerance, I'm talking of bugs and how does the system allow us to recover from those bugs. So let's say you have a bug in the batch jobs. So no problem. You can discard the views and recompute. What if you have bugs in the master data, in your master data itself, where you added incorrect data into the master job? So the answer for this is simple. You reprocess the master data to hide the old data. Here I'll refer Regu's talk during earlier in the day, where he talked about data being immutable and data being a fact. So here we are not deleting the data; we are adding new data that hides the old incorrect data. The implementation of this, can vary, but this is the core concept. And of course, you could have bugs in the query layer because it doesn't have any state. You can just redeploy the query layer. We also get traceability as a side effect. If you see that we are actually computing the computation is happening with intermediate steps. So if there is any problem here, you can trace back and see where the actual problem happened. So you get traceability as a side effect of this. The other problem we saw was operational complexity because of random writes. Now in this batch layer, you don't have random writes. So what you do is we use bulk updates and build the batch view. So there are no random writes happening. But that sounds good, but what about latency? So this is where I'll introduce a new concept called the speed layer. Now the speed layer compensates for the latency of the batch layer. What do I mean by that? So let's say your batch layer takes a couple of hours to run. So any new data that came in the last 2 hours will be processed by the speed layer. And how does it do? So let's say when you get new data, new product data, can be added into the queue. You can use Kafka as an example. And then you can process it at real time using systems like Storm. Okay, now here's where some of the issues with real time processing come into picture. So remember the original problem we are trying to solve. We are trying to get unique products in a category. Now for unique, you need to keep the existing products that are already part of the category in memory. So whenever a new product comes, we see if that product already exists or not. Now imagine keeping this in memory, keeping all the unique products in memory when you have, let's say, millions of products in your category. Now that is a problem because a typical implementation would be, you could use key value data stores, or let's say even if you talk of memory, you're talking of hash maps here, right? So these won't scale. So what you do here is you trade accuracy for memory. So you can use data structures like hyperloglog. These are probabilistic data structures which take less memory, but will give you unique counts with an error, with the probability of whatever error. And you can choose. I mean, if you need lesser error, you increase the memory. So what it means is that, you know, for implementing algorithms in stream layer, you need to trade off on accuracy. You need to trade off on accuracy for memory. And some example data stores that you can use are React, HBase, or Cassandra. But one thing you need to understand here is that, you know, here this random writes and updates are happening. So whenever a new product comes, so we check to see if it's there in the hyperloglog. If it is there, you know, we don't need to add it. But if it's not there, we need to update it. So this is the first time, you know, we are having updates. And finally, you know, you can actually query the hyperloglog to get the unique counts in the speech layer. Now let's talk about updates, right? So I said, you know, mutation is bad, right? But speech layer has mutation. Yes, speech layer has mutation, but it deals only with smaller data. A batch layer might be working with months and years of data, but the speech layer is only working with few hours or one day of data, which means that it's easy to manage that. It's not a lot of data. It's just small amount of data. When you compare it to the batch data. So what it means is, you know, we get what is called complexity isolation. The complexity of handling random write databases has been moved from a large volume batch layer to a small volume speed layer. And the final step here is merging the results. So we saw how the batch layer was calculating the data and how the speed layer was calculating. So let's take an example. So the category count that you get from the batch layer is 50,000, and the speed layer gives, with an approximation, let's say 499, and the final query gives you 50,499, which is not what we wanted. We wanted 50,500, right? So how do we get this accurately? So that's where the beauty of the batch layer comes, because the batch layer is running in a loop. So the next run of the batch layer will override whatever was calculated by the speed layer and give you the exact value. So what you get is eventual accuracy. So with this, I'll formally introduce the Lambda architecture. So you have new data coming in; it goes into the batch layer, into the master data set, and then you have batch views that are being created on a regular basis. You could have multiple batch views depending upon how you want to query them, and then you have the new data also entering the real time into the speed layer to compensate for the latency, and then finally you have the query layer that merges the two to get the results. So a quick overview about how we implemented Lambda architecture at Index. So this is the overlay of the tech stack. For new data, we use Akka. Our real-time crawling engine uses Akka. Our master data set is HDFS. Our MapReduce jobs are run on Hadoop using Scalding, and we also use Spark for some of our ML algorithms. And then our batch views are stored in HBase and Solr. And our real-time layer is actually implemented as a micro batch implementation of our batch layer itself, and then finally we have the query layer there. So a little deep dive into our batch layer. We use an abstraction called Pale that allows us to do vertical partitioning that I spoke about in HDFS. HDFS also has this problem of small files. Pale solves it by using what is called consolidation. We use Scalding. Scalding is an MR abstraction that allows you to write MapReduce jobs in Scala using the higher order functions in Scala. The first version was written in vanilla MapReduce. It wouldn't allow us to write complex. It was difficult to write complex workflows, but Scalding has made it really easy for us. We also use Thrift for enforcing schemas. We use HBase and Solr for views, bulk updates. We do bulk updates to create the views. Speed layer at Index is still work in progress. And to reduce latency, we are using micro batches. We use the last batch run and bulk update the views. If you want to know more details about, you know, how we implemented Lambda architecture, you can actually talk to me, I mean, and the team from Index. We'll be at the Nexus booth today and tomorrow. I'll just spend a few minutes in the open challenges. So one of the things we've realized is, you know, managing both batch and real time is still painful. You know, there are different architectures at play, and you know, so speed is for low latency, but you have to trade off between exactness and large data, and batch is for exactness and large data, but you have to trade off on latency. So it's managing both these systems is really difficult. Now we are seeing two broad directions. We are seeing abstractions that are coming up that try to abstract both the architectures where you write code only in one and it gets executed in both. So Twitter Summingbird is an example. There's also unified stacks, notion of unified stacks that's coming up with Spark, and Spark streaming being the speed component there. LinkedIn is also proposing Kafka and Samza or Storm to unify the two. And Google recently, last month, released their cloud data flow that again tries to solve the same problem. In conclusion, Lambda architecture, it's a different approach to build data systems. It's based on solid principles of immutability and complexity isolation. It's domain agnostic. You can apply it to your domain. But the tools are not yet mature. Here are a few resources. I'm actually writing a series of blog posts on the engineering blog at Index. It's a 10-part series. I've finished two of them. You can go and refer, where I'll go. So if you're interested in deep diving our implementation of Lambda architecture at Index, you can, refer to that. And these are some of the links that you could refer. I'll just stop with the key takeaways and questions.
With respect to the Lambda architecture, there is actually a myth that somehow overcomes the gap theorem. Yes. What's your take on it?
Okay, so I mean, it definitely tries to beat the gap theorem because you're isolated it. I mean, the problems in the speed layer. I mean, so we know that we have to choose between consistency and availability, right? Let's take the partition tolerance out of the way. Now most of the systems would choose availability. So what you're dealing with is consistency. But there the problem of latency comes in. Because if you need to make your data systems consistent, you need to ensure that you are replicating all the data in across systems. So in that case, latency will be high. I'm saying that the speed layer ensures that the complexity of that is actually isolated to a smaller system. I mean, you still have your batch layer, which is available and consistent, but your speed layer, only for the subset of the data is not consistent, but it will be eventually active.
I have a question here. Yeah. So, where exactly do you store the raw data? Is it in HBase or in HDFS?
I mean, right now we store it in HDFS. So the earlier implementation was storing it in HBase, now we've stored it in HDFS.
So why can't you store in HBase as a different column for just
that's a good question. So our original implementation was storing that in HDFS itself. In HBase itself. So what used to happen was the column family of HTML is very dense in the sense that you have 200 KB rows, for example, but your other column family, which is say your past data, only has a few records.
But HBase allows you to arbitrarily isolate and co-locate data, right? You can actually really move your column family to a separate set of machines and not mix with your processed.
But what happens? So when you're running MapReduce jobs, so it has to take the entire row and give it to the MapReduce jobs, right?
No,
in that case, so the number of regions, HDFS, the HTML data is fine. But when you're talking of the column family for the sparse data, or the smaller data, the amount of data that's there in a single region is not high. Which means that the number of mappers that are spawned up is a lot.
Okay, so let me understand.
Yeah.
So it is quite possible to isolate all your raw log data in a separate column family and not mix it with the processed facts which you are going to emerge in a separate column family.
Yes.
So then what is the other problem you said?
So the problem is, when we're running MapReduce jobs on, let's say, the non-raw data, that is the processed data.
Okay.
Because ultimately it's finally raw, right?
Yes.
So what happens is, for a given region, the number of records of the HTML data, number of rows of the HTML data is say 100. The corresponding column families will also be only 100, which means that we are only processing 100 at a time. But you can actually process a lot more of the processed data.
Yeah.
So that's the skew of, because the data sizes are different, the skew between columnar storages, cause problems for us. I mean, we can talk about it offline. The other ones also will be written. Exactly. I mean, there is. I mean, you could actually have a lot more of the process data, but because this other column family gets filled up, only a subset of it is available, and this other thing is already left. Yes. Yes, I mean, that's, so that, yeah, that's, we actually first, I mean, the gradual thing that we did was we moved it into a separate HBase table itself, the HTML column, the HTML column family, and then we, you know, moved it to HDFS. So that sort of progression, you know, helped us, I mean, that this is moving to a separate HBase table was much efficient. And HDFS is, you know, it's definitely working for us really well with the vertical partitioning.
We can do two more questions. We'll stop with you, sir.
So, I do see that the data is split in this case, one in the speed layer and another in the batch layer. And say we have a query, where I have to aggregate data and data is across these two layers. How can we do such a query?
I mean, so there are some constraints there. Firstly, your query should be, they should be associative and commutative in the sense that, you know, if you take sum as an example, right? You can, you know, if you get, you know, 1 and 2 here, the answer is, I mean, you can just sum to get 3. But if you talk of uniques, I mean, that operation is not easily aggregatable. So that's where, you know, I mean, it gets a little tricky. So you have to, I mean, you need to, I mean, that's another thing that we are all struggling also. Some of our algorithms are not easily, I mean, you can't aggregate them. You have to, I mean, there are different data structures that you have to use, and the example I gave of the hyperloglog is a good example where you can implement an associative nature, you can implement an associative hyperloglog and count, and but it will give you approximate values. It won't give you the exact values.
Still, I see it's a challenge.
It's a challenge, yes. It's a challenge.
Okay, thanks.
Your question, sir?
Hey, this is Gauri from Exacta Corporation. So, I'm here. So one of the design principles you mentioned in the slide was to reduce the map reduce timing from 8 hours to probably a couple of hours, right? So when you create different views of the master data, how did it help? I mean, in reducing the map reduce times, in fact, it should be higher, right?
No, I mean, see, you need different views for because your final queries that you're making, right? So I mean, you need to optimize for those. So these the views that, I mean, one thing good with MapReduce is that you can linearly scale. But on the query side, if the queries are not stored, if your view is not stored in the right indexing format, you know, that then, you know, the end users will have a problem, right? So what we do is, you know, we increase the number of machines to ensure that we build the right views which are optimized for the end user.
So you build the row keys pretty much optimized for the query image.
Yes, the views are completely optimized for the final queries. I mean, if you can do it with a single view, you know, you can do it. But in cases where you can't, I mean, there are two different queries and a single view can't solve the problem. We actually create two different views.
Okay, thank you.